from Washington, Crossfire. On the left, Mike Kinsley. On the right, Pat Buchanan. Tonight, can diplomacy still work? In the Crossfire, French ambassador to the U.S., Jacques Andriani, former Arab League ambassador to the U.N., Clovis Maksou, and John Abbey Nader of the U.S. Arab Chamber of Commerce.
Good evening and welcome to Crossfire. Now that a U.S. ultimatum and American diplomacy have failed to force Saddam Hussein from Kuwait, only three thin threads are left on which hopes for peace now hang. First, Secretary General Perez de Cuellar's trip to Baghdad, where he will reportedly offer Saddam Hussein a UN peacekeeping force in Kuwait without any U.S. or allied presence. Second, the possibility of an 11th hour agreement among the Arab nations themselves. Third, the French initiative, an offer to Saddam Hussein of an international peace conference where Israeli withdrawal from the West Bank would be on the table, as well as an Iraqi pullout from Kuwait. The United States has repeatedly, emphatically rejected that idea as linkage. So, are we at dead end? Will the countdown to war continue until the war erupts, or is hope alive? Juan Williams of the Washington Post is sitting in for Michael Kinsley. Juan?
Mr. Ambassador, UN General Secretary Javier Perez de Cuellar announced that he's going to stop in Paris on the way to Baghdad. You've just been in Paris. What is that meeting going to be about?
Well, I guess I don't know exactly, because this meeting was not on or was not envisaged when I left Paris this morning. But I guess he wants to make contact with our president before going on to the Middle East, to Baghdad.
Do you think that he views the idea of this French initiative as something that he has to ride herd on, that he has to try to control, because the French are really breaking ranks here with the coalition against Baghdad, it looks like?
No, we're not breaking ranks. We just say that there are, how many, 5 days left, five days left, and we want to utilize these 5 days to see what can be done for peace. Being understood that, of course, nothing can be done for peace and at the expense of the UN resolutions, that we have to stand on the UN resolutions.
I guess I just don't understand. Syria is not trying to organize a separate peace initiative. The Arabs are not trying to organize a separate peace initiative. And yet the French are trying. What is this proposal?
I think everybody is entitled, it's legitimate from the part of every nation in the international coalition, just as Secretary Baker has been trying to see with talking with Tariq Aziz if there was a chance for peace. So we think we are entitled, just in the same way, to explore until the last minute, that is until the 15th, the chances of peace.
Mr. Ambassador, the United States Secretary of State and the President have said that an offer of an international peace conference where Israel and the West Bank and Palestine would be discussed, as well as Iraq and Kuwait, would be a reward for aggression. Now, has the Secretary of State told your President, given him any of his own views about whether your initiative is a good idea, a lousy idea, or maybe you should go ahead with it?
We are for the settlement of the Arab-Israeli problem, and we think an international conference is an important element in this settlement. This is not a view that we hold since Saddam Hussein has invaded Kuwait. That is something we've been asking for nearly 10 years.
Mr. Baker says to give it now would be a reward for aggression.
Well, I don't understand that. I don't understand that. We've been in favor of this international conference for the Middle East all along. Should we renounce to talk about it just now?
What did Secretary Baker tell your president about you pressing this idea at this time?
They discussed it. Secretary Baker expressed his position, which is not favorable to the international conference.
But you said you could go ahead anyhow.
And our president said very strongly that he thought the U.S. government's view was a mistake.
If American fighter bombers are in the air over Kuwait mm-hmm. and Baghdad and Iraq on the 16th of January, will French fighter bombers be alongside them? And if American troops go into Iraq and Kuwait, will the French troops be alongside the Americans?
They will, yes.
Mr. Ambassador,
they will, certainly. There's no doubt about that. Our president put it very clearly yesterday. There is all legitimacy to explore for peace before the 15th. After the 15th is finished, we enter a new phase. War is legitimate, and we will be in it, just as the others.
Mr. Ambassador, in listening to your point, though, it seems to me you may have had an interest for 10 years in a Middle East peace conference, mm-hmm. but you can't imagine that somehow Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait in order to get a peace conference started.
No,
that was an
not.
Act of aggression.
Yes, absolutely, I quite agree with that.
So why?
So what? Does the act of aggression by Saddam Hussein make the international conference admitted it was desirable before, less desirable now, because Saddam Hussein has invaded Kuwait?
But you don't understand that the Israeli community might feel somehow threatened, that you are somehow willing to somehow put them on the table at this very moment when this man is engaged in an act of aggression against his neighbor and possibly other nations in the Middle East?
But wait a minute, we are not proposing to link the two things at the same table and to say the withdrawal from Kuwait, withdrawal from the Israeli, Israel from the occupied territory. This is not the idea at all. And that kind of linkage, if Saddam Hussein says, if all that amounts to is Saddam Hussein saying, I shall withdraw from Kuwait only when Israel withdraws from the occupied territories, that is unacceptable. That is not what we mean. We press for the international conference because we have been always in favor of that.
Mr. Ambassador,
it's not to reward Saddam Hussein for aggression.
Do you regret that your country sold all those advanced fighter planes to Iraq now when they might be used against French troops as well as American troops?
Well, we were not the only ones to sell arms to Iraq. When we did it, it was in the context of the Iraq-Iran war. We ceased completely selling arms to Iraq after the end of that war. And I must recall that when we were selling all these arms, the Emir of Kuwait, the King of Saudi Arabia, and indeed the U.S. government were pressing us to sell more.
The U.S. government was pressing you to sell more weapons to Iraq?
The U.S. government took a very favorable view to our selling arms to Iraq at that time, yes, indeed.
Mr. Ambassador, quick question. Do you think there will be a war?
I'm afraid so. I'm afraid so, but until the 15th of January, it's still permitted to have some hope.
Thank you very much for being with us, Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you.
When we come back, can the Arab world save itself from war?
Music proudly presents Country USA, the most complete country collection ever, bringing you the legendary stars and their biggest hits.
Hey, good looking. What you got cooking?
Hello, darling. Nice to see you.
Year by year, you'll enjoy the biggest hits of country music in one great collection.
They say.
Start with 24 original hits from the year 1962.
So break out the bottle. Bring on the crowd.
I've got your picture. She's got you.
Devil woman, let me be. And leave me alone. I wanna go home.
She thinks I still care.
Country USA. USA 1962. Two LPs or double length cassette, $9.99. Compact disc, $11.99. From Time Life Music. I'd
like to have your credit card ready and call toll free 1-800-477-6900 or send $9.99 for two LPs or one double length cassette, $11.99 for one CD, plus $3.50 shipping to Country USA 1962, P.O. Box 1880, Department 2, Alexandria, Virginia.
The rematch of the NBA Finals, Portland at Detroit.
A ref!
Followed by the Cleveland Cavaliers and the L.A. Lakers.
Woo, baby!
The NBA on TNT, tonight at 8.
Bigger than life.
Welcome back. Is there a chance to avert an American-Arab war in the Persian Gulf, and can the Arabs themselves find a solution that Americans and Iraqis could not? We take up that question now with two men familiar with the Arab world and the Arab positions on the Gulf who are just joining us. They are Jean Abbey Nader, president of the U.S. Arab-American Chamber of Commerce, the U.S. Arab Chamber of Commerce, and Clovis Maksoud, who's the former ambassador to the United States and the UN from the Arab League. Ambassador Maksoud, you think there's 85% of the American people, according to a survey I saw tonight, believe there's going to be a war. You don't. Why not?
Well, I think there is heightened anxiety at this moment, but I think also that it is diffusible. I think that what has taken place in Geneva was not a success, but it was not a failure. I think that for the first time, Americans and Iraqis talked to each other instead of talking at each other.
How in the next 4 days is this thing going to be defanged so that there's no war?
Well, I think that there is the brokers, or the diplomatic catalysts, who are now been licensed by the United States and I suppose by Iraq to try the efforts to bring about a formula by which the Iraqis could say they are, quote, sacrificing and withdraw. They might want to give it to the presidents of Algeria, non-aligned countries.
What are the components of this deal that you see? Is the French offer of an international peace conference after they get out, is that part of it? Is the UN peacekeeping force that the Secretary General talks about part of it? Is Kuwait's offer or the discussion of Boubian Island and the oil field part of it?
Well, all of them are part of it, because what you're finding is that the Secretary General is offering a peacekeeping force, which is logical. This has been done in the Congo, and I think that precedent is now there. It has been done after 1956 aggression on Egypt in Sharm el-Sheikh. And I suppose that what the peacekeeping force would ensure, one, total withdrawal of Iraq, two, the deployment on the borders, three, deployment in the Warba and Boubian to ensure Kuwaiti sovereignty over these two islands and Iraqi access to them.
Mr. Abbey Nader, what are you hearing from Arab nations in that Gulf area? Are you hearing that there are any realistic negotiations going on in secret at this moment?
My reading, as late as late today, before coming to the show, talking both to people in Saudi Arabia and in Egypt, is that the elements of the deal, if you want to call it a deal, but more what they prefer to call it are the conditions for understanding, have been on the table for a long time. And that, in fact, ironically, there's a school holiday beginning in Saudi Arabia January 14th, and a lot of people are going on holiday in Saudi Arabia. So even there is a conviction that the game's not played out, that in fact, as Ambassador Maksoud said, the game is just starting. The negotiations for the first time have started and not ended. So it's a half-glass, half-full scenario.
But are they negotiating? Is there some negotiation going on now that we're not aware of?
I think that one has to understand who has leverage in order to deliver Saddam Hussein, who has leverage in order to deliver the United States. The difficulty has been, until this point, the Arabs haven't been able to, because the Arabs who talk to Saddam Hussein are not the Arabs who talk to the United States.
Let me ask Clovis Maksoud this, Mr. Ambassador. Saddam Hussein has got to be delivered. Mr. Bush has made his last statement. On the 15th of January, he's going to be authorized by both the Congress and the UN to use force, the Senate by a narrow margin. I mean, if you understand American politics, the president is probably going to be pressed to use that force earlier rather than later, because the coalition here and the coalition over there isn't getting any stronger.
Well, I think that if Saddam Hussein is to be delivered, he would not want to be delivered to the United States at this particular time. He would want to be delivered to the non-aligned countries, to perhaps maybe the Europeans and to the Arabs.
The only European left is the French initiative, isn't it?
Oh, no. The French initiative is a part of a European initiative. It is the pivotal factor in this European initiative in the same way as the Algerian initiative is part of an Arab initiative.
Wait a minute. Do you expect that on the 15th or maybe the 16th, Saddam Hussein will say, in response to requests from friends and allies in the third world, African nations, Algeria, and in response to initiatives from the Europeans, we have decided to move X, Y, and Z, which can defuse this crisis?
I think so, yes, because otherwise the alternative. I not only think so, I believe that that is a very feasible and credible
option. Because he is afraid of war.
He's afraid of the consequences, and he's afraid of the fact that these people who have taken a position which was not confrontational, like Algeria and Tunisia and Jordan and others, have a great stake. They don't want to be drifted into a war which would be devastating for them, and therefore I think he would be deferential to them. And I think the important thing that people like President Kawanda, who's today in Baghdad.
Kenneth Kawanda.
I think that he is urging also withdrawal, and I think that he would want to deliver what he might call sacrifice to this kind of people who did not ostracize him in the same way as he was ostracized.
You're saying that Saddam Hussein can make a gesture to these people who, unlike the Americans, are not confronting him. They're coming as friends.
Friends, but they're coming as interlocutors, yes.
And you think Saddam Hussein can and will make some kind of gesture by the 15th or 16th of January?
I think so.
Now, let me get this straight now. Just what about the PLO? The PLO, as I understood it, sent an emissary this very day to France to talk there with Roland Dumas, the French foreign minister, to try to make some arrangement, but I don't quite understand what role the PLO is playing here. Do you understand?
I think the PLO, at best, are well-intentioned messengers. I don't think they have leverage either within the major players in the Arab camp, which are Algeria, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, and Kuwait at this time. I think that they are fighting for their survival and their identification as the leaders of the Palestinian people. I think they want to remind people that they are involved in this from two points. One, they do oppose the Iraqi annexation of Kuwait, and number two, they want to see a peaceful solution. They have been consistent about that, although I might say their methodology has been pretty counterproductive.
Ambassador Maksoun, what happens in the Arab world, say, on the morning of the 16th, if American 1,000 fighter bombers, American, British, French, Saudi, are bombing Iraq?
Well, I think that people underestimate the fact that there is an Arabity at that time. I think people who are now very much opposed to Saddam Hussein's policies, who have suffered as a consequence of it, I think they would be very reticent to be in confrontation with him, in spite of the fact that what I heard what President Mubarak said today, I think that there is a very vital inter-Arab dynamics which would prefer to bring a peace option. I think we'll have a situation, unfortunately, of great anarchy.
When we come back, we're going to take a look at the question of what happened when Perez de Cuellar goes to Baghdad. Is that the best and last hope for peace in Kuwait? Thank you.
Scratches at all.
That's when music was music.
It's got everything.
Ramblin' Man.
Benny and the Jets.
All from CDs.
Introducing Entertainment Weekly's Rock Archive CD Collection. It's free with a paid subscription to Entertainment Weekly.
Everybody's doing a
brand new dance out.
This drum, which is just thundering in here.
This
This exclusive Rock Archive collection has 30 of the most listened to hits from the 60s to today, remastered and compiled for the first time on two beautifully produced CDs or three audio cassettes. And the Rock Archives will sound even better when you hear that it's free.
What?
Do I have to pay taxes on it?
It's free when you subscribe to the magazine everyone's talking about, Entertainment Weekly, at a savings of almost 50% off the cover price.
Entertainment Weekly is the postmodern farmer's almanac.
It's a great magazine.
Entertainment Weekly is like a quick fix on what's out there.
It's concise, it keeps me current.
I love the pictures.
Get kind of the behind-the-scenes look.
It cut to the chase. I want to talk about music and movies.
I like it because I don't have to be hip.
Entertainment Weekly's more than great reviews. It gives you the inside scoop and a behind-the-scenes look at movies, television, videos, books, and more. Call right now and get 18 issues for three monthly installments of only $5.99 each. Or use your credit card today.
Walk like
I think that's really how people walk in Egypt.
Call right now, and you'll also get Entertainment Weekly's Rock Archives, 30 classic rock hits on two CDs or three audio cassettes, and it's free.
Things like this don't happen to me.
It's stupendous. It's outrageous.
Totally awesome.
It's inexplicable. How could you beat that?
Wishing I was Rod Stewart waking up with Maggie May.
So call and subscribe today. You'll save almost 50% on Entertainment Weekly, and you'll also get the Rock Archives set free.
Mr. Abby Nader, when Perez de Cuellar goes to Baghdad this weekend, what do you expect to happen?
Let's go back to the point of that you asked earlier about delivering Saddam Hussein. I think the point here is that he can't be seen in his own context of giving in to the United States. And for our own purposes, the United States, we have to make sure that this is not perceived finally as a U.S.-Iraqi battle, as you pointed out, the first American-Arab war. So I think what he can deliver, number one, is international cover. Number two, he can say, listen, 2 weeks ago we passed a resolution in the UN which included a statement by the president of the council that we're going to talk about Palestinians. So you've got the elements there, and we can tell you it's going to happen even though the United States can't tell you it's going to happen.
Ambassador Maksoud, let's suppose the American war against Iraq lasts 3 or 4 weeks, and then American ground troops have them pinned down basically in Basra and Kuwait. What happens across the Arab world?
Well, first of all, I have been so much committed to the peaceful option that I can't envisage except a certain turmoil throughout the Arab and perhaps Muslim world. And I feel then what you would have is a real south-north confrontation. And
Would the members of the Allied coalition, the Saudis, the Egyptians, others, would those regimes stand? Would they be in trouble?
I think that a lengthy conflict, a bloody conflict, would make everybody's position untenable. And I think that Secretary de Cuellar will be going to see Mr. Saddam Hussein. He'll have two files with him, I suppose. I mean, imaginary files. One file about the Security Council resolutions pertaining to the Iraq Kuwaiti conflict, and another file about the Middle East situation, the Palestinian question. He probably would tell him that I am coming, I want you to help me in addressing these two files. Let us get this file over by withdrawal. Mm-hmm. I have the assurances to give you a peacekeeping force, etc. And then this would help me addressing the other file more dynamically, in as much as the United States has energized the Security Council on the Kuwait issue and has paralyzed it earlier on the Palestinian issue. I am sure that now we can energize the Security Council on the Palestinian question through an international conference or otherwise.
Ambassador Maksoud, thank you very much. Gene Abbey Nader, thank you again for joining us, old friend of Crossfires. Juan and I will be back with final words on Last Chance for Peace in a moment.
We went to the fight capital of the world and asked the fans, who's the greatest heavyweight ever?
By far, it's Muhammad Ali.
Ripping punches,
Muhammad Ali.
Who's the heavyweight champion of the world?
Sports Illustrated presents Muhammad Ali, the video. It's free with your paid subscription to SI.
It brought back memories, things I'd seen and hadn't seen.
Not in this
Paul Avino.
God's former.
Joe Frazier.
He float like a butterfly and sting like a bee.
Foreman goes down like a
free slip by lightning.
And the Muhammad Ali video is free.
How can it be free?
It's free when you subscribe to Sports Illustrated. Save over 50% off the cover price.
Kind of like Muhammad Ali, it gives you everything.
You'll get 23 issues, including the baseball preview and the swimsuit issue, for 3 monthly installments of only $9.89. Or you can pay by credit card.
This is Ali at his very best.
People who never had seen Ali would love this tape.
You can't walk away from this tape without being a Muhammad Ali fan.
Hold it.
You're not that free.
Call our toll-free number now and get knockout savings on Sports Illustrated and get the Muhammad Ali video free.
I shook up the world!
No one knows when news will strike. But if you are there and you get it on tape, CNN wants to show it to the world. See it. Shoot it. Send it to CNN News Hound. Call 1-800-544-NEWS.
Pat, this week, Secretary of State Jim Baker's meeting with Tariq Aziz came up with a big zero. Baker couldn't even get Tariq Aziz to take the letter from President Bush directed to Saddam Hussein. Has American diplomacy gone far enough to try to achieve peace, or does George Bush simply want a war?
I don't think President Bush wants a war. I don't think Saddam Hussein wants a war, but both men will accept war rather than what they perceive as humiliation. And I think for the president to back down would be total humiliation, same as Saddam Hussein. The only way to get this thing resolved is, I think as Ambassador Maksoud says, somebody's got to give Saddam Hussein something so that he...
This is CNN.
From Washington, Crossfire. On the left, Mike Kinsley. On the right, Pat Buchanan. Tonight, stand and be counted. In the Crossfire, Indiana Republican Dan Burton of the House Foreign Affairs Committee. And from Capitol Hill, Colorado Democrat Patricia Schroeder of the House Armed Services Committee.
Good evening and welcome to Crossfire. Throughout the day and into the night, the House and Senate are debating whether to authorize President Bush to take America into war if Saddam Hussein does not get out of Kuwait by midnight, Tuesday, or whether to deny him the authority to launch an American attack.
What's the hurry? Impatience is no reason to go to war.
Patience at any price is not a policy, it's a cop-out.
Will I be able to look at the parents, the wives, the husbands, and the children in the eye and say that their loved ones sacrificed their lives for a cause vital to the United States and that there was no other reasonable alternative?
Saddam Hussein, if you don't leave Kuwait, we're going to attack, and we're going to attack in January.
Tonight, will Congress give Mr. Bush a green light for war? Or will it tell him he has no power to go to war without a future vote of Congress itself? Juan Williams of the Washington Post is sitting in for Michael Kinsley. Juan?
Representative Burton, you're from Indianapolis.
Right.
You just got back from Saudi Arabia. I want you to imagine that you have to go to Indianapolis and see the parents of some of these young men and women who are out there. Are you going to be able to tell them that there was no alternative, that we had to go to war and had to give up the lives of their sons and daughters for this cause now?
Nobody wants war. I just got back, as you said, and I talked about 35 of the families of the people over there. I'm concerned about those young men, but I'm also concerned about the problems that we're going to have if we don't deal with this man now. He has to get out of Kuwait. If he stays there, it's my opinion that he will grow in stature in the Arab world. He'll have maybe hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of more followers in the years to come from Iran, from Syria, from Egypt, and elsewhere. He'll develop nuclear capability, and I think we'll have to deal with a much more difficult problem down the road, and maybe many more casualties if we have to go to war.
Nobody's,
but nobody wants war.
Well, nobody wants war, and nobody denies Saddam Hussein is a bad man. But at the same time, why next week? Why not give sanctions a chance to work?
Well, you have to look back. The United Nations passed this resolution clear back, I believe, in August. And here we are 5 months later, and he's still sitting there thumbing his nose at the world. I mean, how much time do you give him? How much time do we allow those young people to sit there losing their jobs, their businesses, and everything else? How much time do we give him to develop additional terrorist threats and activities that would harm people not only in the Middle East but in Western Europe and here? I mean, there's a lot of things that are going on right now that we're going to have to deal with, and it's going to be tougher later.
Pat Schroeder, if your leadership, Mr. Mitchell and Mr. Foley, after the president added the 200,000 troops, had called you back into session, you could have debated this and you could have decided that no, We don't believe we should go with a January 15th deadline. Mr. Mitchell and Mr. Foley instead went along with the president. And now you are debating in the House a resolution to deny the president authority after the Baker Assize meeting when there is tremendous emotion and the president is about to win. Did your party make a terrible mistake in November?
Well, I think you have to ask Foley and Mitchell that. I was one who said we should come back. Secondly, I think the answer that they will give you, I don't know that it's totally valid, but the answer that Foley would give is that 10% of the Congress was going to be new in January, and if you came back then, would you have to redo it in January? Would that authority hold? Was it fair to allow a lame duck Congress to make those kind of decisions when we had just had a fresh election? We'll probably be debating that forever. All I know is I am very pleased that we're debating it now, finally. I wish we had done it long ago, and I think it's terribly critical that we really get on with it, and hopefully, there's a chance we can still win.
Pat Schroeder, the reading that we're getting here, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that President Bush is even stronger in the House than he is in the Senate, that tomorrow the Congress, the House, and the Senate are going to vote to give the president the authority to go to war, with the margin, as I say, in your body even higher than in the Senate. Would you contradict that?
No, I wouldn't contradict that. I find it shocking, because I always find that normally the House is more in touch and up for votes more often. I think part of it has been we did not have the leadership of our committees that the Senate did. They had none. They've had all sorts of boring, very established people, whereas we have had to fight our committee heads who've been on the other side, and I think that's been harmful.
Why have they? Men like Solars and others who have been doves for years, and yet they're joining now with the Republicans. Why have you lost so many in the House?
I'm not really sure, and again, I think you should ask them. I don't think it's fair that we should. All I know is that I am really terrified by the war fever running. I don't see the reason that we have to hurry and do this. Congressman Burton was saying, well, you know, we had 5 months. Look how long we've sat with the UN in Korea, for heaven's sakes. Patience is one of the virtues of a great power, as far as I'm concerned. And I see absolutely no reason that we as a great power are throwing patience to the wind and deciding we have to run after this guy when everybody would stipulate we're going to get him no matter when we do it.
All I can say is that she obviously has not been doing her homework. I think every member of the House has been getting information on this on a daily basis. We've been briefed. I was with Colin Powell today. We've had him before the Foreign Affairs Committee. Steve Solars has heard all the information. All of us have. And we understand what's at stake here. And for those members to say, oh my gosh, this is the first we've heard of certain things, is really a cop-out, because we've had information coming to us on a daily basis for a long time. This president has done everything in his power to make sure the Congress is as informed as possible.
All right, let me ask you,
I disagree.
Why does, Saddam Hussein has held Kuwait for 5.5 months. Mm-hmm. If he held it for 5 weeks more, what vital interest of the United States would be jeopardized?
The problem is the Hamilton resolution is open-ended. And if that thing were to prevail, we could be there 6 months, a year, 2 years, how long? And when I talked to Hosni Mubarak, of the president of Egypt, he said, how long will the coalition last? How long will your country allow the people to sit there, losing their jobs and so on and so forth? How long will the resolve of the United States and the coalition last? And Saddam Hussein has the ability to stay there indefinitely. The sanctions, according to William Webster, our CIA director, and all the leaders I talked to,
outlast the greatest country in the world.
I think he can outlast the coalition and the resolve of this country.
I find that absolutely outrageous. Let me respond to that in two ways. First of all, when you look militarily at any country, you look at first their capabilities, then you look at their intent. If they don't have the capabilities to carry anything out, you don't worry about their intent. The very interesting thing is, every single day those sanctions hold, he has less and less capabilities, because we know heavy equipment's not getting through, oil's not getting out.
Well,
it is true.
Militarily, his capability is not decreasing at all. You haven't talked to the Joint Chiefs of Staff. I just talked to Colin Powell today. Why don't you call him up?
We have listened to him. We've listened to Director Webster. We've listened to all of them. The things that are getting through are flour and sugar and things like that. They can throw flour and sugar at us. The stuff that's getting through is stuff they can get through on mule trains and cars and things like that, but they are not getting through major military equipment, supplies, and they're not getting their oil out to get their cash.
What are you hearing from home, Pat Schrader? Are you hearing from your constituents that they are in favor of the president going to war or not?
Absolutely not. We're running about 11 to 1 in our responses. People are very frightened, and they can't understand what the American interest is, have to go to war on the 15th.
All right, let me contradict you there, because, our mail here is getting very much, is also anti-war, but if you take a look at the national polls, the president's support is 2-1 for his policy. For going to war in the next month, if you add those who want to go to war on the 16th and in February, January and February, it is almost 80% if the guy doesn't get out. What is your mail saying? Because the polls contradict the mail everybody's getting.
Well, I'd say the opinion is evenly divided, but nobody wants to go to war. I don't like that term, we want to go to war. What we want to do is obtain or reach the objective that we set in the first place, that President Bush did, and that is to get him out of Kuwait and get him out as quickly as possible.
You know, you still haven't told Pat what is the U.S. vital interest that's at stake here.
What answer am I going to tell the parents?
There's a number of vital interests that we have to be concerned about. We have to be concerned about stability in the Middle East. We have to be concerned about...
You're going to start a war to enhance stability?
International law. We have to be concerned about the energy that's there. That's a problem. We have to be concerned about the future stability of the entire region.
That's what those protesters said when they ran into the halls of Congress today and talked about blood for oil. People don't buy it.
Only one part of the equation. It's not the whole thing. There's a multitude of reasons why this man can't be staying in Kuwait and growing in power and stature in the Middle East. Like I said before, I think his popularity is going to grow if he stays there, if he's perceived to be a victor in this thing. And if it grows, we're going to have to face a much bigger problem in 3 or 4 or 5 years. He's working on nuclear capability right now. He's already got chemical and biological weapons. And he's working on a delivery system, not only intermediate range, but intercontinental range.
Do you want to keep filibustering and you want to keep yelling, but let's piece all these things together and they make no sense. First of all, you are telling us we have a coalition that will hold together if we go to war on the 15th, but the coalition won't hold together for peace. We can't do an embargo any longer because the coalition will fall apart. What kind of coalition is that won't hold together for an embargo but will be great if we go to war? Well, that's the kind of allies we have. They want to be behind us, they don't want to be alongside us. That is the point we're trying to make. Next, if you look at our Arab allies in the region, they have 2 million men in arms. This is their neighborhood and their bully. I think we should be there to help, but they should be alongside. That we're making it all the U.S. against Saddam Hussein, and that's how we're making him a hero. We're making him a hero by putting the entire world focus on him.
Okay.
And I think we ought to be aware of that.
Okay, when we come back, we're going to talk about the threat of terrorism in Europe, Africa, Latin America, and even here in the United States, on which members of Congress have been briefed what could happen if war breaks out this coming Tuesday night or Wednesday morning.
Okay, what's new with the new generation of Oldsmobile?
Still wondering?
This is the new generation of Olds.
People like you are determined to win. You don't settle for being second best. Neither do we. We're Century 21, and if you want to make the most of your future, talk to us during Career Opportunity Week. We're the largest real estate sales organization in the world. So if you want to be among the best at Century 21, it's as good as done.
If you have an insurance repair on your home, and you have Allstate, it's in our hands. We know some very reliable contractors. It's our business, too. So if you choose a contractor we recommend, we guarantee the workmanship of their repairs for 1 year. That's why you're in good hands with Allstate. A member of the Sears Financial Network.
The reason two Oldsmobiles made the 1991 Consumer's Digest Best Buys list is based on the same philosophy Oldsmobiles are built by.
exceptional value.
This is the new generation of Alt.
Saturday, his country is in the middle. Among nations divided in the Persian Gulf, how will Jordan react if war breaks out? Jordan's King Hussein talks with CNN's Evans and Novak, 12:30 p.m. Eastern Saturday.
And just so there is no misunderstanding whatsoever, let me be absolutely clear with all of you. We passed the brink at midnight on January 15th.
Welcome back. We're talking about the vote that is going to come tomorrow, probably in both the Senate and the House, to authorize or not authorize the president to take the country into war after midnight Tuesday. The probability now is that the president will win both of those votes. We're going to take up now, I understand Congressman Burton, excuse me, our guests are Representative Pat Schroeder, who's up in the Capitol right now and who is with us, Democrat. She is going to vote not to authorize the president to go to war. And Congressman Burton, Republican, who is on the other side, Dan Burton, and he is going to support the president all the way. Congressman Burton, you cannot talk about it. I understand you've been given an off-the-record confidential briefing about probability or possibility of terror in the event of war. This is the public statement that the State Department has issued. It says, we have evidence terrorists supported by Iraq are planning to mount attacks in most regions of the world. The Middle East and Europe are the most likely locations. They have reports of terrorists planning in Africa, Asia, and Latin America in the event of military action involving the United States. All Americans traveling abroad should review existing travel advisories concerning the country or region to which they plan to travel. Americans overseas should stay in close touch with the nearest U.S. embassy or consulate. Be alert and pay attention to anyone who may be observing them. This is in Europe, I gather.
Right.
Let me ask you, and especially near military facilities, is there anything you can tell us about the talk of threats to Americans right here in the United States?
Well, I don't want to get into detail about that because it is a classified briefing. I'll just say that there is the real threat of terrorism, not only in Europe and the Middle East, but I think around the world. And that's another reason why that we can't send a signal that this country is going to be intimidated by Saddam Hussein or anybody else.
Right.
We've got to let them know that we have certain goals and objectives, and we're going to achieve those. And if they use terrorism as a threat, it won't work.
And you think it's just coincidental that they gave you this briefing today? You think it's coincidental that the vote's taking place right now and they're trying to force your hand as a congressman?
We had Democrats and Republicans there, and I don't think this was in any way designed to influence our vote. I think it was designed to make sure that we were aware of the situation.
All right.
In the event that
let me make an argument here. We are so close now to the deadline for war, and the president believes he has the authority to attack. Whether you give him that specifically or not, would it not strengthen the hand of the one man who can deal with Saddam Hussein, namely President Bush, if the Congress gave him, in effect, unanimous endorsement now, knowing that he could go to war anyhow? If you gave him that kind of support, would it not send a message to Saddam Hussein that, look, the Americans are behind him, maybe I might best deal?
I think that if we voted against giving him that authority, it would be an incredible message to the Iraqi people that here the people rule, here we have a democracy, we can have a free debate that's beamed over there on satellite that they can see it. We aren't going to get shot for voting that way. If we don't think the January 15th date was a smart thing, then we can say no. We're saying yes to everything else. We're saying yes to the Desert Shield part of it. We're saying no to the Desert Sword part of it until more time has gone by. To me, that would be the strongest democratic message we could beam around, and that would be very harmful to Saddam Hussein.
That would be great, Pat, if the Iraqi people had any say in anything, but they don't. That's a dictatorship.
Well,
he controls that country with military power. He's a brutal dictator. He's even used chemical weapons on his own people.
A year and a half message, ago, beaming, you would have said
just
the
a minute,
same
Pat,
thing
let me,
about
let
Eastern
Pat, let him
Europe.
Finish.
Let me finish.
Pat, let him finish.
I mean, if you think that sending that signal to those people is going to influence Saddam Hussein, it won't. He's probably watching this show right now, and he's got to know that the United States has the resolve to do the job. And that's the only influence that's going to be felt over there, Saddam Hussein, not on the people of that country.
We're not talking to Saddam Hussein. We're talking to the people of that country as the same kind of television forces talk to the people of Eastern Europe and many other countries where the people finally said, hey, there is another way. Thank goodness. There's no more Iron Curtain. You can't seal this off.
Pat, your former president, Jimmy Carter, said today that if the condition of making peace, if the condition for avoiding war is telling Saddam Hussein he can have an international peace conference where Palestine will be discussed as well as Kuwait, if, I mean, he will withdraw, but he gets that peace conference. Jimmy Carter, I believe, said in effect, why not give him the conference, linkage or no linkage? Would you object to President Bush saying, look, I'll go along with an international peace conference?
I would object to that. What I really wish we had done was gotten the Arabs that were backing us, Mubarak and the many other forces, and have them call for it and say we are going to push for this because they are supporting us and they are on the right side. I don't want to give any credit to Saddam Hussein for using this, because let's be perfectly honest, why did he do this? Not because he cared about a peace conference. He cared about the price of oil. He was very clear from day one.
Pat, if this is the fig leaf Saddam Hussein needs to walk out of Kuwait, would you give it to him?
Well, I think that that's not going to be the fig leaf. I think he walks out of Kuwait first, and I want to give that to the others who have to deal with him who are in the region, and that's why I think our policy hasn't been right on target there.
Pat, do you think is there any reason that you would approve of using military force in that situation? And when? If not now, when?
Well, obviously, we make out very clear in the Democratic proposal when we would allow it now, and that is in defense of Saudi Arabia, in defense of our troops who are there on the ground if they're attacked, and to enforce the embargo. Now, to go further than that, if you go on for another year, the sanctions continue to stranglehold him, and he is now much weaker, but he still insists that he's not going to move, and you've had time to try and get maybe do peace conferences or whatever because of the other Arab countries and not Saddam Hussein, and they get the credit, then maybe you decide, well, there's something we should do. But I want to see them alongside of us and not behind us. I want it to be a world effort.
Okay. When we come back, if the president wins the vote in both houses, will the Democratic Party get behind the commander-in-chief if he decides to go to war?
Back in 1966, Oldsmobile brought on a revolution with front-wheel drive. Today, the evolution of Smart Trek, the combination of all-wheel drive and anti-lock brakes, will again take the world by storm.
This is the new generation of
When the sun and the rain have slowly worked their magic, and the fruit is simply at its best, it's picked for Smucker's Simply Fruit. Pure, fresh, uncomplicated. Smucker's Simply Fruit is 100% fruit. Pure, spreadable fruit. Smucker's Simply Fruit. Just about the closest thing to fresh fruit you'll ever taste.
When her littlest patient's coughing, it's the biggest thing on mom's mind. So now there's new cherry-flavored Robitussin Pediatric for long-lasting cough relief. New Robitussin Pediatric Cough Suppressant, recommended by Dr. Mom.
Ask any two people to describe the New Yorker, and chances are you won't hear the same word twice. For those who want the intellect stirred, there's Pulitzer Prize-winning fiction. For those who want wit, there's humor and satire. Plus, the latest on music, art, dance, sports, and of course, the New Yorker's famous cartoons. Get 52 weekly issues of the New Yorker for just $25.95, 70% off the newsstand price, and get this brand new cartoon collection free with your paid subscription. Call 1-800-257-1257.
The reason two Oldsmobiles made the 1991 Consumer's Digest Best Buys list is based on the same philosophy Oldsmobiles are built by. Exceptional value.
This is the new generation of Olds.
The nation of Turkey literally sits on top of the Middle East conflict. Turkey's President Turgut Özal in an extended conversation about the quest for peace on Crisis in the Gulf, tonight 8 Eastern on CNN.
Congressman Burton, all this week it's been floated in this town, it's going to be a short, brief war. Casualties are going to be limited, 3,000 to 5,000. Do you believe a word of that?
I hope and pray that we don't have a war. But if we do, I hope it's short. But I don't think once you start shooting, anybody can give you any guarantees. If you've ever been in military, if you've ever been in combat, and I've talked to a lot of people who have, and I've been in the Army, I can tell you that you can't guarantee anything. We just hope it will be, and I think we'll use everything in our arsenal to get the job done.
Pat, briefly, President's going to win both these votes tomorrow, we think. As of now, we're not sure. If he does, will the Democratic Party get behind the commander-in-chief as he plays out the last couple of days here and maybe takes us into war?
I think there's no question that at that point we all rally. This is a democracy, and at that point the majority does rule. We have no choice.
Thank you very much, Pat Schroeder. Dan Burton, thank you very much.
Thank you, Pat.
Juan and I will be back with final words in a moment.
Yes, sir.
I'm Gene Randall in Washington. Ahead in our nightly special report, Crisis in the Gulf, Saddam Hussein uses a religious appeal to rally support among Muslims as Iraq prepares for war. Debate rages in the U.S. Congress over whether to authorize force against Iraq, and a look at the U.S. battle plan if there are hostilities. Join Dave Michaels and me at the top of the hour for Crisis in the Gulf.
Occupation of Northern Ireland.
Get out of Belfast. You're in danger here.
Secret death squads of Britain.
It's an intelligence matter outside your jurisdiction.
A worldwide cover-up.
They want this thing buried.
A truth that can never be buried.
I don't ask your cooperation. I demand it.
The political thriller of the decade. Hidden agenda. Every government has one.
Now playing. Check newspapers for local theaters.
Do your kids like to read?
My kids hate to read.
Then give your kids a subscription to Sports Illustrated for Kids.
They love reading about sports figures.
Over 4 million kids think it's fun to read. Kids read each issue over and over. Teachers love it too.
A sports magazine for kids would show them that reading can be fun.
Sports Illustrated for Kids has it all. Exciting photographs, inspiring stories.
Sports Illustrated for Kids is something that Dana and I could read together.
Through their heroes, kids learn about being good winners and good losers, and it gets kids interested in the world.
Dana could understand that you can't always be a winner.
I think Nicholas would really benefit from seeing what other kids are doing all over the world.
Subscribe now. Get 12 exciting issues, paying 3 monthly installments of only $5.98. That's 23% off the cover price.
If Sports Illustrated for Kids gets my daughters to read, it's a bargain.
Kids love getting it in the mail.
She would be absolutely thrilled to get something in the mail.
So call toll free. Subscribe to Sports Illustrated for Kids today.
Tomorrow, maybe Shakespeare.
Tonight, Ross Perot, the Texas billionaire who masterminded a daredevil Mideast escape, says he's got a plan for peace in the Middle East. Meet him tonight on Larry King Live, 9 Eastern on CNN.
Tomorrow night at 7 on Capital Gang with Newt Gingrich. As guest panelists, we will discuss the debate on the war, which will be concluded by then, probably in both houses, and Perez de Cuellar's last chance for peace trip to Baghdad, which should also have its returns in by then. At 7 p.m., CNN, Capital Gang.
Pat, we're talking life and death here with this debate going on in Washington over the last 2 days. Are you convinced that we have done all as Americans to reach a peaceful resolution? And if so, why not give Saddam Hussein his peace conference?
Well, I think the ball is in the court of Saddam Hussein now. If he says, I will get out of Kuwait and I will start out on the 16th or 17th, and I would like an international peace conference, I think what President Bush will then say is, we're not giving him anything, but we've said a peace conference down the road is something we'll look at. I think you'd have it solved. But the key now is Saddam Hussein. Mr. Bush has given him his ultimatum. His deadline's coming up the 15th. If he doesn't do something by then, I think we'll have a war within 72 hours.
I'm going to tell you right now, Pat, history is being made. George Bush is being judged. Even you and the conservative Republicans in this country aren't comfortable with what George Bush has done until this point when we all feel we have to rally behind the flag. It's a dangerous time, Pat.
Well, nobody's going to be comfortable with the war. Dan Burton isn't. I'm not. You're not. Nobody is.
All right. From the left, I'm Juan Williams. Good night.
From the right, Pat Buchanan. Join us tomorrow night for Capital Gang at 7 p.m. and Monday for another edition of Crossfire.
For a transcript, send $3 to Crossfire Transcripts. Journal Graphics, 267 Broadway, New York, New York, 10007. Or call 212-227-READ.